You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces eliminate Pakistan-backed terrorists in Kashmir. Afghan peace talks in jeopardy as Taliban shoots down US plane. Pakistan take cosmetic measures on terror outfits. And protests emerge in Pakistan after the arrest of Pashtun activist. This week too, Pakistan continued with its nefarious agenda of unleashing violence in Jammu and Kashmir. Indian forces, however, gave it a befitting reply by eliminating one of the top commanders of proscribed terrorist group, Jaish-e-Mohammed. The Indian Army now claims to have completely wiped out the terrorist group that was responsible for the deadliest attack in recent Indian history, in which 40 paramilitary personnel were killed by suicide attack in Pulwama. Hours of relentless exchange of bullets killed three terrorists from Pakistan-based militant outfit in Jammu region of Indian state of Jammu and Kashmir. Although unclear, the attack was deemed as revenge attempt from terrorists only days after Indian Army claimed the complete eradication of deadly Jaish-e-Mohammed. One of the militants was killed on spot while two others were killed later. A truck driver was held by the police while a helper and another truck driver who ran away were later apprehended by the police.
There are four terrorists possibly. Three have been eliminated. One, we are looking for the fourth one. There were three civilians including the truck driver and the helpers.
Police said they saw some suspicious activity in a truck near a toll booth on a key national highway, NH44, that connects Kashmir to the rest of the country. During search operation, one of the militants fired on police, injuring one of them, after which police retaliated. Police chief confirmed that terrorists infiltrated into Indian territory from Pakistan as the new recruitments in Jaish-e-Mohammed terror outfit, which had lost all its operatives in an operation carried out by the Indian Army.
This group has crossed from IB, from Dialachak, Hiranagar area, and they have come in the morning today only. They were lifted by the truck last evening from that area, and they were on way to Srinagar. The group, as per preliminary reports, belonged to Jaish-e-Mohammed. We have also captured the truck driver and the conductor in one of our nakas. Further interrogation of those people is on. So whatever further details are received, that will be shared with you. Let me tell you, very large quantity of arms and ammunition have been seized from them.
Earlier, Indian security forces gunned down three terrorists, including a self-styled commander, Kari Yasir of Pakistan-based terrorist outfit Jaish-e-Mohammed in Jammu and Kashmir. Based on specific inputs about terrorists hiding in the targeted area of Thral district in Jammu and Kashmir, a search operation was launched during which terrorists fired upon the security forces, triggering an encounter.
So today morning we got information of some terrorist of Jaish-e-Mohammed who were planning to do some act of terrorism on 26 January in village called Haripari Gam in Thral Baul. So today morning the operation was launched. The module of Jaish-e-Mohammed, which is basically the Pakistani terrorists, was on a radar for a few days. One of them was eliminated a few days ago, where we also lost a Jawan.
Indian Armed Forces have lately intensified their efforts to decimate terrorism from the valley, and the terrorist groups like Lashkar-e-Toyba and Al-Badr have been pushed to the brink of extinction. Major operations in last few days have resulted in the killings of several terrorists. Many others have also been apprehended. With the elimination of Qari Yasir, the brain behind the training of Fidayeen squad of Jaish-e-Mohammed, and a key member in last year's Pulwama attack, Indian Army claims to have wiped out the group's leadership.
Tino militant ko neutralize kar diya gaya. Hamare intelligence ke hisab se usme Qari Yasir hai, jo Jaish ka self-assigned Kashmir ka chief hai. Ye last year February mein jo blast hua tha, usme bhi involved tha ye. Lethpura bhi blast hua tha, usme involved tha ye. Aur uske baad ye ID expert hai, recruit bhi karate hain aur bahar se jitne bhi bahar se militant aate Pakistan se usko bhi relocate karate hain aur coordinate karate hain.
The previous year saw a terror attack when a vehicle filled with explosives rammed into a convoy of Indian security personnel on the Jammu-Srinagar National Highway in Pulwama district, which killed 40 personnel of the Central Reserve Police Force or CRPF. The Indian Army has launched a series of operations to free Kashmir of all terrorists. Pakistan has stepped up its devious agenda of sending across more terrorists into the Indian territory since New Delhi decided to get away with the Article 370, a provisionary article that kept Kashmiris away from rest of India. These terrorists are always on a lookout to infiltrate into Kashmir, which is facilitated by constant and provoked ceasefire violations by Pakistan Army. According to Indian government, Pakistani troops made the highest number of ceasefire violations in the last 16 years along the Jammu and Kashmir border in 2019, amounting to over 3,200 instances on an average of 9 such violations daily. Of these, 1,565 ceasefire violations took place since August 2019 after the abrogation of Article 370. Pakistan's multiple failures in its proxy war have not just dented its spirit, but have also exhausted its coffers. Its violent obsession with India has rendered it multi-layered losses and a fall of more than 2 units in GDP growth rate in little over 20 months is a truth it will find hard to digest. Moving on to Afghanistan, where the peace talks that were on the brink of hitting a breakthrough just a week back might have met a roadblock following Taliban claims of downing a US plane, Bombardier E-11A. Although Washington have dismissed the claims, citing technical failure behind the collapse, the Taliban intend to attack US forces, despite Washington agreeing to most of their demands, can potentially throw a spanner in the works, a report.
Bombardier E-11, an aircraft that was being used for communication support by US Air Force in Afghanistan, crashed down in the disputed Ghazni province on 27th January. While US says the cause of crash is still under investigation, the Taliban, who hold a firm control over the province, have claimed that they attacked it for intruding into their land. Zabihullah Mujahid, a spokesman for the Taliban, said in a statement, the plane was shot down for attempting to gather intelligence in Sadu Khel area of Dehyak district of Ghazni province. Mujahid, however, did not say how the fighters had brought the plane down. He said the crew on board included high-ranking US officers. A senior defense official denied that senior American officers were involved. Washington has so far denied making any statement on its claims.
I'm aware of the situation. I have nothing further to report at this time. As the matter develops and we develop it, we will update the media.
The Taliban has been waging a war against US since 2001 and has had several successes in its stronghold of Ghazni province. The crash, which comes as the Taliban and United States have been in talks on ending the 18-year-old war in Afghanistan, were on the brink of announcing a deal. Earlier also in the month of September, the peace process was sabotaged in the final stage after President Trump called it dead, citing killing of a US soldier in Taliban attacks. Talks resumed and reached same point as Taliban expressed their contentment on social media. Taliban had even extended a talk proposal to Kabul establishment and a 10-day ceasefire with US troops with reduction in violence to follow. However, this attack, which they claim to have carried out might have undone all the gains made in the recent talks. Two separate incidents of killing of over 20 security personnel in Kunduz and Balkh are suggestive of an unchanged stance and strategy of Taliban despite all the talks. The government of Afghanistan, which has declined Taliban's proposals of talks, has, however, continued their operations in different parts of the country. It has been carrying out both land and air raids to contain the rapidly expanding clout of the insurgents. An escalation in confrontation means a further deterioration in the security situation of the country, divisions and damages to the peace process and the dream of return of peace that has remained elusive, becoming unachievable.
Pakistan, which has a reputation in global arena for its unending support to terrorism and terrorists, has not taken any action against them despite FATF's repeated advisories and warnings. It has, however, made colossal claims on international platforms of doing everything to rein in terrorism. In one recent case of its so-called tough measures against terrorism, two dreaded terrorists of Jamaat-ud-Dawa were prosecuted and awarded 15-day imprisonment for their involvement in terror financing, a report. In what could be termed a desperate exercise, Pakistan has sentenced two dreadful Jamaat-ud-Dawa operatives to 15 days of imprisonment. The verdict comes just days ahead of a crucial meeting of Financial Action Task Force in February in Paris. Even after its sustained presence in FATF's grey list, Pakistan has failed to curb the funneling of funds to terrorist groups like Jaish-e-Mohammed and Jamaat-ud-Dawa. This decision of an anti-terrorism court in Pakistan makes it very clear that Pakistan has no real intentions of acting against terror groups. Federal Investigation Agency had earlier arrested them during Islamabad's cosmetic crackdown on the banned outfits in a bid to express its obligation towards the Financial Action Task Force.
Well, 15 days of imprisonment really doesn't come mean anything. If you look at the circumstances in which Pakistan is, it's better to go a little bit into the background of why are they at all trying to display that they are in the business now of really tackling terrorism. I would say it's all the pressure that's come on them because of the Financial Action Task Force having once again put them in grey list. They have been very lucky. They skipped the blacklist. Somehow the Chinese and Turks and also Malaysia perhaps helped them to really keep to be kept out of the blacklist. But that's what really drives Pakistan today to show that they are taking action against terrorists. Otherwise, if you have convicted somebody for a crime, which an anti-terrorist court gets to the point of saying, yes, it's a crime which requires punishment, and that punishment is only 15 days, it doesn't actually serve any purpose. It's no deterrence whatsoever.
In its plenary meeting in October, FATF warned the country of strong action for its failure in combating money laundering and terror financing. Under pressure from the international community, the Pakistani authorities launched investigations that were later proven to be shoddy and incompetent. It targeted Lashkar-e-Toyba, Jamaat-ud-Dawa and its charity wing, Falai Insaniyat Foundation, or FIF, for their holding and use of trust to raise funds for terrorism financing. At least 56 seminaries and facilities being run by the JUD and FIF in southern Sindh province were also taken over by authorities in the same case. Hafiz Saeed, the co-founder and chief of these terrorist groups, was also arrested, but there are greater chances of his release owing to absence of substantial evidence against him.
Hafiz Saeed has been moving around freely all over Pakistan. Intermittently, he's been put under house arrest, he's been put under arrest. But ultimately, every time it comes back to the same point that he seems to have enough room for, interacting with his organization, giving them necessary instructions, guidance, and, leading them into this business of terrorism. So, Hafiz Saeed is a case study by itself which proves that Pakistan is not serious at all in terms of getting even the terrorist leadership that has been already, let's say, indicted by international organizations, and they have been designated as terrorists, to be kept out of this business altogether, to be really arrested or legal action taken against them. There is no sincerity of purpose displayed whatsoever in the way Pakistan has been dealing with Hafiz Saeed.
Despite getting warnings from the world authorities, Pakistan does not seem to take any stern action against terrorists operating on its soil. In fact, Pakistani authorities are providing every kind of support and cover to these terrorist groups. Pakistan's covert support includes not providing any protection to the witnesses of terror financing cases. This results in various terrorism-related cases suffering excessive delays as witnesses for the prosecution hesitate to testify. According to Dawn, an esteemed Pakistani newspaper, around 1,700 cases were pending for 42 anti-terrorism courts by the end of November 2019. With a conviction rate of just 17%, anti-terrorism court acquitted accused persons in around 1,857 cases as authorities failed to produce witness and evidences. Protection of witness should be of the utmost importance in fighting terrorism cases, but Pakistan does not consider rendering it fundamental attention, let alone putting it on the top. And such token punishments given to terrorists are nothing but eyewash to prevent the negative fallout of the international pressure seeking to rein in terror groups operating from its soil. Moving on, intimidation and draconian legislations have been Pakistan's go-to tool to suppress any form of dissent. Whether it is about silencing Balochs, Kashmiris or Pashtuns, the modus operandi has remained the same. In the line of same policy, Islamabad recently arrested Mansoor Pashtin, the leader of Pashtun Tahafuz movement, and slapped him with charges of criminal conspiracy and sedition. However, it wasn't unprecedented, as Pashtuns are more than often arrested on trumped-up charges of terrorism.
Mansoor Pashtin, a human rights defender and a Pashtun activist, was arrested by Pakistan for his tireless campaign against the Pakistan Army's brutality. Mansoor Pashtin was taken into custody in Peshawar, along with 9 other protesters of Pashtun Tahafuz movement, which advocates the rights of ethnic Pashtuns affected by Pakistan's war against the Taliban. Later, a Pakistani court rejected the transit bail plea of Pashtin, who was represented by his lawyers. Court accepted the police's request to shift Pashtin to a jail in Dera Ismail Khan, where a first information report has been registered against him. Illegitimate arrest of Mansoor Pashtin is the testimony to long-term atrocities on Pashtun community.
पे एक वॉर उन्होंने डिक्लेयर की हुई है पश्तूनों के खिलाफ, तो आपको ये भी अंदाज़ा होगा कि तकरीबन 75,000 लोग वहाँ पे कत्ल किए हैं इस आर्मी ने, और ये भी है कि ये जो सिविलियन को कत्ल किया है इस आर्मी ने, इसमें एक तालिबान या अलकायदा लीडर पाकिस्तान आर्मी ने नहीं ना पकड़ा है ना उसको मारा है, और आपको ये जो 87 बड़े बड़े टेररिस्ट को मारा गया है फाटा में, उसमें से 86 को अमेरिका ने मारा है ड्रोन्स के ज़रिए, और ये जो एक मरा था वो भी आर्मी मेजर था रिटायर्ड, वो खुद ही उसने अपने आप को एक्सप्लोड किया था। तो इससे आप अंदाज़ा कर सकते हैं, और इसके अलावा 32,000 इन्फोर्स डिसअपियरेंसेज हैं वहाँ पर, और 2.5 मिलियन पीपल लोग मुख्तलिफ टाइम में उनको डिस्प्लेस किया गया है, तो एक बड़ी ह्यूमैनिटेरियन crisis hai wahan pe.
The arrest of Mansoor Pashtin has raised the nationwide protests. Hundreds of people took to the street of Pakistan after a Peshawar court rejected his bail plea. Demonstrations were also held in various other cities in Pakistan, including Pashtin's home district of Tank, located close to Pakistan's restive tribal areas. The non-violent protest by Pashtuns have been on a rise since the extrajudicial killing of a young man of ethnic Pashtun heritage by police in Karachi. This conflict follows the long history of marginalization, atrocities, and enforced disappearances of the community by Pakistani authorities. Manzoor Pashtun for long has been leading demonstrations defending the rights of Pashtuns. However, it is the first time Pashtun has been arrested in such a case.
Extrajudicial killing takriban 2005 se shuru hua hai tab jab yahan hamare mashran hamare ilake ki aman ki baat karte the to wo namalum afraad ki taraf se maar diye jate the.
Despite being a strong and dominant tribal group of Pakhtunkhwa, Pashtuns have been oppressed at large extent by Pakistan's most powerful institution, the Pakistan Security Forces. Pakistani army, which was meant to protect them from extremism and terrorism in the Taliban's hotbed area, has turned out to be worse than the Taliban. The situation is so bad that in case of a suspicion about any Taliban links in the village, the Pakistan army completely decimates the entire village by bulldozing the homes of Pashtuns in order to inflict collective punishments to entire community village.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Surbhi Sharma, signing off on the behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.